Let's start off with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you. We thank you so much for being so good and so generous to each and every one of us. Thank you so much for this lesson we're about to learn. Dear Jesus, it's about your life. It's about what you've written for us to be able to know you a little bit closer, more intimate, and to have a closer relationship with you. How we love you, Lord. I just pray that you would just bless this time. We're going through all the Gospels and just the good news of what you've done for us. We love you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' powerful name, we do pray. And all of God's people said, amen. 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 First of all, to introduce the series that we're doing, it's going to be the Yeshua, the Life of Messiah, from a Messianic Jewish perspective. It's written, this particular one was written, well, originally by God. It's the Gospels. It's the four Gospels. But we're talking about the person who wrote the actual book that we're going to be studying is going to be Arnold Freudenbaum. He spent much of his life working on this. In most cases, what you would have in the Life of Messiah, you'd get it from a Western point of view or from a Greek or Roman point of view. But in this case, we've gone back and he's gone back and looked at the context of this being a Jewish messianic Messiah. Whenever you see the word Yeshua, don't be alarmed. This is not a different person that we're talking about. It is Jesus. It is Jesus in Hebrew is Yeshua. Everybody say Yeshua. Yeshua. Very good. So every time you see the word Yeshua, don't let it throw you off. Also, messianic just means that it's of Messiah. It's messianic. It is of the Messiah. So that's important for us to understand. In the study, you're going to find that we're going to be using words like the Matthew or Mark or Luke or John. Like in the case of John, he'll be referred to as Yohanan, because Yohanan was the actual name of John in Hebrew. So those things like that, I'll go ahead and clue you in as we go through. Also, there's a lot of good information that you're going to have. If you notice, there's a number here, it's 1 out of 197. There's actually 197 different chapters to the life of Christ as it's broken down, or certain paragraphs. So as a result of that, we have that 1 out of 197. If you're already discouraged and you think, that's it, this is way too long, well, let me discourage you even further. Okay, this is probably going to take us 2.5 years to go through, okay? But we're filming it now, and we'll have it on archived and ready to go, so that if we ever have to share that with anybody else, we can. Or if there's something that you want to look at and look it over again, you'll have the opportunity to do that. So be praying for us as we start this adventure, and in the year 2024, we should be done. All right, here we go. As introductory material, it starts in the life of Messiah. If the life of Messiah could be encompassed by a circle, the circle will contain everything Yeshua ever said and did, from individual incidents and teachings to every aspect of his entire life. When each one of the four gospel writers was inspired by the Holy Spirit to write an account of the life of the Messiah, none was able to include everything Yeshua said and did. Yohanan, John, the apostle, admitted this at the end of his gospel. It says in John 21, or as I like to say, Yohanan 21. And there are also many other things that Jesus did, which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. Amen? Amen. Because it says amen at the end, so you're all supposed to say amen. Okay, thank you. So then, what I've done is, if you think about it, in this illustration, I think it kind of helps you have a better understanding of how the writing was taking place. How did Matthew come up with the gospel that he has, and then Mark, and then Luke, and then John? Well, each one of them had a perspective, something that they were looking at. And so based on the perspective, they would choose the incidents or talk about those incidents as it related to the target area that they wanted. Now, the target area for Matthew in this case was going to be the Jews. And it was important for him to illustrate the kingdom or the kingship of Jesus as the Messiah. So Matthew, if you look at Matthew, he would have chosen, out of all the different stories that are out there, he would have chosen, okay, let me look at my theme. Let me look at where I'm going with this, where I want to, this is my target audience and stuff. He says, this account in A and this account in C work really well with what I'm trying to project in the gospel. So he chooses this incident of Jesus and this particular situation of A and C and says, these two work well for me. So he takes those and he brings them out. But he says, but B doesn't really work very well within the confines of the story. But on this case, in the case of Mark, Mark is his whole look is towards the Mark is towards the Romans. And it's all about accomplishment for the Romans. So he's writing to the Romans specifically to their mindset. So he's looking at this and says, okay, there are three stories here, but you know what? I don't see that A works for me in my perspective, but I do like B and I do like C. It's just like me. I like B. Okay, anyway. And so you have A, B, and C, and here you have all the different things that they're choosing based on what they're writing or their perspective of what they want to do. So I thought it was really important because I've never really taught this from their perspective. Like whenever you read John, any of the Gospels, you're always reading it from the same perspective. You're always thinking that they're looking at it from your point of view. And so you just read it through and so forth. But wouldn't it be great if there was a way that we could actually, as we're teaching it, we teach it in a way where we know what the target audience was or who he's trying to reach. So what I've done is I've basically done these characters that are here, and this should help us a little bit more. When we're talking about Matthew, Matthew has two things that he's really want to make sure that he gets across. The first people, he's the first gospel that goes out, and the first people that needed the gospel, needed information, were the Jewish people. So it's addressed to the Jewish people, and the main item of that, of what he wants to talk about, it has to do with the Messiah as king, King Messiah. So now everything that he writes will be from that perspective, a Jewish perspective, to reach the Jewish people. So then you'll have information in there that will go ahead and share, get that to the Jewish people. This is why Matthew starts with a genealogy. Why? Because he wants to make sure that he gets the information to the Jews that Jesus indeed is in the line of David. Okay? So then the next thing that you see is you see Mark. Now Mark has a whole different approach. Mark got a chance to go out with Barnabas and with Paul, saw the Roman world, and decided to write from a Roman to the Romans from that perspective. So here you have Roman. It's like Hail Caesar. Okay, here's we have, not this Caesar, but this Caesar. We have the Romans. And here you have a check mark. Romans, their whole point of view was a checklist. Get things done. How fast can you get things done? Accomplishment. If you look at the whole Roman Empire, they built it based on how fast you could do things, how efficient you could be, and it was all about action. That's why if you ever did anything to the Roman government at all, the Romans would send out their legions, and their legions would not come back until they were finished with a job. And how fast they finished with a job meant how far they went up in leadership as generals. So that was the whole point of view. So if you look at these guys, these are all kind of type A, get it done, and mark it off and do that. So every time we're looking at any scripture that we're dealing with Mark, then it's going to be having to do with a Roman perspective. When we look at Luke, when we look at Luke, then we find out that there's two things that we're looking at. One of them is if Mark was Romans and Matthew was Jewish, then this one is Greek. Luke is all about giving the Greek an opportunity to understand from their perspective. And it was important because if you remember, Luke has gone out with Paul and has taken the time to go out, but he's already gone on. He's gone to Greece. He's been in Macedonia. He's gone on through all the areas of Galatia, all these things up in Turkey and so forth. So he's familiarized himself with that people group, and now he wants to write towards that people group as well because it's important. So and with this people group, it has a lot to do with the clock here has to do with chronology, or the Greeks looked at everything like in a timeline. They wanted to know historically how things happen and in what order they took place. So Luke does that. In fact, we're going to see the first chapter in Luke. It starts off with addressing the idea that even though these two had already been published and these gospels were already out there, he felt the need to put everything in an orderly way. Okay? So he does that based on the fact that that's the way the Greek mind was thinking as well. He also will talk a lot about the manhood of Jesus. The fact that he was thirsty, he was tired, he was all these different things, because they wanted to see that, and they also wanted to see how he illustrated the persistence and the manly man that Jesus was. And because that for them was a really important thing, that mentally, philosophically, that he would be strong, and Jesus was the very best, and also physically, that he would be a person that would had high ideals for his body as well. So that's what Luke does. So he writes that. Now John writes at the very end. He's writing about the year 95 or so, 90 to 95. All of these are already out. The scripture's already out. They've been circulating already. And so then everybody's getting a pretty good thing. So he decides, you know what? I'm going to do a general look. It's the world type of view. So for God so loved the world, that's the whole idea. You have a lot of words like love and a lot of words like the world and light and darkness. All those things he's talking about in kind of general terms, but he's talking about everyone. That's why when we talk to somebody about the Lord, we say, look, read the book of John, because John really does address the lost. So he's looking at that. So he's addressing the lost, but then also he's addressing the deity of who Jesus is, who Messiah is. And because he does that, then we have this idea that, okay, if Luke is talking about Jesus or Yeshua as a man, then I'm going to be talking about Yeshua, Jesus, as God. This is why John starts off his gospel with, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God. He wanted to make sure that he started it all off with that perspective. So imagine as we're going through the gospels, we're looking at each one of them, we can always make sure that we can always look at these and kind of remember. So what I've done with this is I've actually, for every slide that we've done, for every slide, this will be always on the side of the slide. So that whenever we're talking about it, we're talking about Matthew, I'll refer to, remember Matthew, what is his perspective? And if we're talking about Luke, or remember Luke, who's he talking to? And it'll give us, I think, a better indication of what the message, why the message was fashioned specifically to that people group, okay? The bottom line is it's all Jewish. It's really important because we don't get away from that. It's all going to be Jewish. But the perspective of how they introduce this Jewishness to the people groups is what makes it really important for us to understand. So the first gospel, as order of introductory, the first gospel has a theme. It's Yeshua the Messiah, the King of the Jews. So that he is Jewish, that he is Jewish and that he is the king as well. Each gospel writer tried to meet a specific need. Naturally, since the first believers were Jews, the need would have originally arisen among them. Initially, Jewish believers stayed together under the direct authority of the apostles, who had been eyewitnesses to all that Yeshua said and taught. If a person had a question such as, what did the Messiah say about this? Or what did the Messiah say about that? He could go to an apostle, ask the question, and get the answer. Now, just think about that. Just think about how cool that would have been. So you and I were talking and said, I wonder what Jesus thought about this, this, and this subject. You know what? We should go. Peter's only like about 3 blocks away. You know, he's on Roslyn. Okay, so let's, or 2 streets down. Let's go talk to Peter. And so you could actually go and get firsthand information about all things that you were curious about. And so all the apostles were all available for everyone to be able to go. So you're getting firsthand information on a one-to-one basis. Nothing's been written at this point. Everything is just by word, and everything's been translated and moved on and so forth. But nothing has actually been codified to bring in all the Gospels written down. So what you have is that you have the option to have all or any of the apostles readily available for questions, which is like, that blows my mind, just the idea that you could actually do that. Now, something else happened, though. What happens in Acts of chapter 7 was the stoning of Stephen. That all changed after the events described in Acts 7. As a result of the persecution that followed the stoning of Stephen, the Messianic community of Jerusalem was scattered throughout the Middle East. They started going and attacking all the believers, and the believers decided to leave Jerusalem, and they went on to different parts of the world. So when that happened, guess what? This access that you had to all the apostles is no longer there. Unless you sent somebody to go find somebody, get the question, and send it back to you, if you were in Galatia or if you were in another part of the world, especially like in Antioch. Many of them went to Antioch into Syria. So there was no longer one central unified body of believers under the direct authority of the apostles. While the apostles stayed in Jerusalem, many in the Messianic community went to areas outside the land, such as Antioch. That's up in Turkey. Now that the Jewish believers were dispersed and they were no longer under the direct influence of the apostles, they needed an authoritative source to which they could refer as they proclaimed Yeshua the Messiah, as the Messiah to the King of the Jews. So now the Jews had Judaism, and they had different writings of the Mishnah and the Talmud and so forth that they could refer to. But then now they're saying, oh, but we want to refer to them. We need something that we can have to refer the gospel so that if they ask us, we can have something to talk to them about. So that's the whole point of Matthew. To meet that need, Matthew wrote his gospel and made heavy use of messianic prophecy to show that this man, Yeshua, Jesus of Nazareth, fulfilled all those prophecies that predicted the coming of the Messiah. So they were asking the questions. Well, how do we know that he was the Messiah? And Matthew was answering the questions. Let me show you his lineage. Let me show you his genealogy. Let me show you the miracles that he did. Let me show you how he dealt with the law. Let me show you, and then let me go back to show you prophecies dealing with his first coming, the coming as a child and so forth. And that's where you have some of this information, because the Jewish mind had to have proof. It had to have a sign. It had to know that that indeed was going on. The purpose of Matthew's gospel was to show that this Yeshua, Jesus, really was the messianic Davidic king. Matthew explained more about God's kingdom program than any other gospel writer did. Another important aspect of Matthew's gospel is that it is written in light of impending judgment. If you remember, Jeremiah was sent as a prophet right before Nebuchadnezzar came and took them into exile. And so he was the prophet telling them of impending doom. The same thing is about to happen. Matthew then becomes the one person that writes in the Olivet Discourse. He writes about the impending doom to come. That is because of the unpardonable sin of unbelief by the rulership. Therefore, the kingdom was not going to be established. And the consequences of that is AD 70, the destruction of Jerusalem as a result on the temple. So he's putting out warnings. And in fact, any warnings that you get for the people that got any warnings, it was because Matthew felt the need to share that information because it was relevant to Jerusalem and to believers, and that they should get out at a certain time when they see certain things happening. So Matthew is really important, did that and made sure that was so important. Why? Because he's taking care of his people. Matthew writes in light of the coming Roman destruction of Jerusalem and the Second Temple. Because a king had been rejected and the unpardonable sin had been committed, Jerusalem was now under the judgment of coming destruction. The Jewish believers would have to respond in a specific way when that judgment came. And this gospel is written to prepare them to deal with that issue. So when you see Jerusalem surrounded, then that's the time that you must leave and go, so that all the messianic believers all believed the gospel of Matthew in order to be saved, and they left the country, and then that's when Titus comes in and destroys Jerusalem and burns down the temple. Okay? So that's pretty much all of Matthew. Now we move into Mark. The Gospel of Mark, Yeshua the Messiah, the servant of Jehovah. Once again, who is the target audience of Mark? The Romans, okay? And then what was their perspective on, what was the perspective that he had to, what was their mindset, the Roman mindset? Organization, accomplishment, getting things done, the checklist, okay? So from that we see the Gospel of Mark, Yeshua the Messiah, the servant of Jehovah. While Matthew wrote for the Jews, Mark wrote for the Romans. In the culture of that day and in the context of the Roman Empire, their main interest was action. They were far more interested in action than in teaching. They wanted to know, what do you do, not what do you say? What have you accomplished? What have you done for me lately? That sounds like a really bad boss. Okay. So Mark was far more interested in recording the deeds of the Messiah than he had taught. The ideal Roman was someone who could receive a commission, carry it out, and come back as quickly as possible to report that mission had been accomplished. I know some of y'all are Romans, okay? Boy, I know one in particular. Mark presented the Messiah as a man of action. He pictured him as someone who had received a commission. Jesus got a commission from God, and who is eager to carry it out. In the Gospel of Mark, there is a rapidity of action, a sense of urgency, a sense of immediacy, a sense of getting the job done. Over 40 times, Mark uses the Greek word "ithaios" or "euthus," translated three different ways in the English Bible as immediately, straightway, forthwith. Since Mark wrote for the Romans, he emphasized the immediacy of obedient action on the part of Yeshua. In other words, with Mark, you're going to find a lot of things that have to do with, and he immediately went and did this. Or he found out that somebody had a problem or there was a need, he immediately went and accomplished that. So you can see how Mark is really very much really talking about Jesus as this person who accomplishes things. And he's telling the Romans, you built an empire. Jesus is building an empire. And now do you want to be part of this empire? And so that look of Jesus was very appealing based on the fact that that's kind of how they were thinking and that's how they wanted to do things. Although Mark pictured the Messiah in a context that would communicate to his Roman audience, he did not forget his own Jewish frame of reference. Why? Because he's Jewish. He used a theme developed by Isaiah the prophet as the background to his gospel. The prophet's favorite title for the Messiah was the servant of Jehovah, the servant of God, who was sent by God to accomplish a certain mission. So this is why in Mark, the emphasis then is that this is what God gave him a commission to do. He came on this world and he started to accomplish those things. And he was a man under authority. He says, everything that I do because the Father tells me to do it. Everything he does, he brings honor and glory to the Father. All of these things are all about submission and submitting under authority and working under authority and completing the job at hand under authority, which is very Roman, right? It's all about authority with the Roman Empire. So that was important why he does that. Mark portrays Yeshua as this ideal servant of the only true God, a servant who was willingly, obediently willing even to go to the cross, because that was the mission he was to accomplish. And that's important because when you think about it, one of the great traits of our Messiah is the fact that he was willing to go to the cross and die and accomplish the mission by way of that death. It could have been accomplished maybe in other ways, but this was the form, and he was obedient. And it says he was obedient even unto the cross in Philippians chapter 2. So you see some of this coming out. He had a commission to carry out, and he straightway forthwith and immediately fulfilled his tasks. Mark's intention was to show that Yeshua of Nazareth fulfilled what Isaiah said about the servant of Jehovah. Our third gospel is the Gospel of Luke. The Gospel of Luke is, who is the main audience for that? It is the Greek. And what is their main thing? Order? A chronological order, timeline. It was for them, they wanted things done in a certain way. They were one of the biggest proponents of keeping records and keeping a historical record of even other dynasties. And so it was really important for them. They wanted to know, when did this happen? So you're asked, well, other ones are saying the actions, oh, he did this and he did that with the Romans and so forth, because they want to know that. Or where the Jewish is, well, show me some prophecy of how that works within Judaism. Then with Luke is all about, let's put this in order, because the Greek like mind thinks in an orderly fashion. And what's happening is these type of things really give us a really good picture of who Jesus is from different perspectives. And so you see him in these different roles, but always and from a Jewish perspective, which is really important. So here, Yeshua is the Messiah, the Son of Man. Luke wrote his gospel to emphasize the humanity of the Messiah. While Matthew wrote to the Jews and Mark to the Romans, Luke wrote to the Greeks. The Greeks had two major areas of interest. The first area was their concept of the ideal man. This would be someone who was self-disciplined, Jesus, fit, Jesus, agile in both mind and body. What's important is that this is why philosophy was such a big deal, because of the mind. And it was important, that's why they used to have Olympic games and Isthmus games, because of the body. They considered to that to be a high ideal. And Jesus was both, okay? It says, the Greeks revered philosophy and philosophers such as Socrates and Aristotle, and they revered athletes and athletic pursuits such as the Olympian and Games. Luke presents Yeshua, Jesus, as such a person, one who had full control over his thoughts and his body. And to the humanity of the Messiah, it is Luke who tells us how he developed from his youth. Luke is the only one that talks a little bit more about his physical way of how he matured and how he went on. More so than the other gospel writers, he notes that Yeshua was hungry, thirsty, tired, etc. It is man that needs to eat, drink, and sleep, not deity, for God never gets hungry, thirsty, or tired. Behold, he that keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. That's true. And that would be the idea of the writing of John, because John is talking about the deity of God. But for Luke, he's talking about the actual physical person of Jesus. The second major area of interest to the Greeks was historical accuracy. Many of the earliest histories came from Grecian records. For instance, much of what is known of ancient Egypt stems from these sources. It is this second area of Greek concern, historical accuracy, which explains why Luke chose to write his own gospel the way he did. In the first two verses, he admits that other narratives were already available, which was going to be Matthew and Mark. And indeed, the Gospel of Matthew and Mark were already in circulation, like the Gospel of John. They were written by eyewitnesses of Messiah's life. Luke, on the other hand, became a believer through Paul's ministry after Yeshua had lived, died, risen from the dead, and ascended into heaven. So why did he feel the need to write an account of his own when he himself had not witnessed the life of the Messiah? The answer is in verse 3 of Luke 1. It seemed good to me, also having traced the course of all things accurately from the first, to write unto you in order, most excellent Theophilus. So he's saying it's really, really important that even though we do have two Gospels already, but that we have an account that is in a chronological order that will tell us exactly. So when the Greek mind says, well, when did this happen? It happened in this place. And what happened here? Well, that would be happening over here. And so it would bring an order into the life of Messiah, and that was the whole point. The Greek word for in order is cathexias, which means one after another, successively and in order. This shows Luke's motivation. He wanted to communicate the Messiah's life in a way that it would appeal to the Greek mindset. For the Greeks, an accurate chronological history would verify a claim. Matthew, Mark, and Yohanan, the apostle, were not concerned with a strict chronological sequence. So they organized the events of life of Yeshua according to their themes. Luke, on the other hand, was concerned with the chronological sequence of events, and thus this study will always follow his order for one simple reason. He alone stated that he had put his material in chronological sequence. So basically what we're doing is that there's been other books that have come out that deal with the harmony of the gospel. And A.T. Robertson is the one that really actually did the work and put all the, what we call the synoptic gospels, all the gospels in order as they appeared. So as they went to a particular situation, you might have all four commenting on that, or only one or two. But anyway, it gives you a chronological thing. Now, the difference between Ariel's harmony of the gospels is that where A.T. Robertson decided that he wanted to go on and do it a certain way, layout a certain way, there were times where it deviated from Luke's chronological order. But seeing as how his whole purpose for writing this was to write it in chronological order, then this one and the book that we're going through is actually going through that chronological order of Luke, as he stated it already. By the way, these are four-volume books for Yeshua the Messiah, and these are available at Ariel Ministries. Excellent. This is the abridged version that doesn't have all the quotes of all the rabbis and all the thoughts and everything that went into it. So this is a good one if you're just going to go through it. It's pretty easy. And then this one here is going to be all the scripture verses in the order that they're being brought up in the book, and also as they appear in the scriptures as that happens on a timely basis. Also, there's also a book, CD, a video on this whole class, which is the abbreviated version of the 15-year version that we're doing on this class. Okay, so not having been an eyewitness of the Messiah's life himself, Luke needed to assess to people who had walked with Yeshua personally. So where did he get the information? So he was in the area of Jerusalem for 2 years while Paul was in prison in Caesarea. And this was the time he would have had access to all the eyewitnesses. Matthew and Mark would have been available to tell him of their experiences with Yeshua. And Luke obviously spoke with Miriam, the mother of Yeshua, Jesus, or Mary, the mother of Jesus, as he revealed her actual thoughts, things she had kept in her heart. Do you remember the fact that that Luke is the one that is telling you the story of the of Mary, and how all the things that happened to her, and how she was feeling, and all these things? Well, where did all that information come? And in most cases, we think in terms of, well, the Holy Spirit just gave him the information and he just wrote it down. But actually, what Luke is doing is he's actually going and talking to, remember, everybody's still alive. So he's getting his firsthand information, and he could ask the question. And imagine this. I mean, this is kind of cool. Imagine you're Luke, and you go and you're talking to Mary, and you're saying, or Miriam, her Jewish name, and it says, so Miriam, tell me, how did you feel about that? I mean, how did you feel about all that was going on with you? And she says, well, it was very difficult because I had to hold in all this information about who my son was, and I didn't understand, and so as all this is being written down, you're actually getting an interview from Mary herself. And you never think in those terms. You always think of it in terms of, well, it was supernaturally. It was just, you know, Luke was sequestered somewhere in a room, and then he gets all this information. But he's actually asking all of the apostles, getting all this information and gathering it all up. Of course, the Holy Spirit is right in the middle as to what is going to go in and who he's going to talk to and the leading and all the different things that goes on. But there was something very practical about that, the fact that they were all still alive and all could bring in this information that was so needed for making a chronology. So this is your investigative reporter, Luke, coming in and picking up all the information for all of us to be able to have. And I think this is the first time that I had ever really thought about the fact that, wait a minute, how did Luke know how Mary felt? Because he's the only one that talked about how she felt. And here's a perfect example of how that happened. It says, how would Luke have known her inward secret thoughts unless he had actually talked with her? Luke says the account of the eyewitnesses were delivered to us from the Greek word paradoson, referring to something that was handed down. This was normally a Jewish term for something handed down by tradition. And also remember that everything up to this point was handed down what they call by oral tradition. It was talked through, but it had been talked through all the way since Adam. Information had always been passed down the line, all the way down the line. And so all this information was verbatim to quotations and everything that was going on down the line, because they were very good at that. They didn't have the resources for scrolls and for writing and all these different things, but they did have a way of communicating information down the line. So a lot of this information was being given, handed down, as it were. This was normally a Jewish term for something handed down by tradition. Luke had three special concerns. His first concern was Jerusalem. He revealed that Yeshua said what Yeshua said and did in this city, and he taught things about Jerusalem that other three Gospels writers left out. While in the book of Acts, the movement from Jerusalem to the uttermost parts of the world, in Luke, the story begins and ends in Jerusalem. Luke's second special concern was the Gentiles. That's important, because he wanted to bring in that particular area. He recorded details of Yeshua's ministry among them and his teachings and saying about them that the other gospel writers chose to omit. Why? Because that was not their concern. That was not their focus. But it was for Luke. Luke's concern makes sense because he was led by the Lord, by Paul, to the apostle, to the Gentiles. According to the book of Acts and Paul's epistles, Luke traveled frequently with Paul when he was engaged in Gentile evangelism. It is obvious that he shared the apostle's special concern for these people. Luke's third special concern was women. We're going to skip that. No, I'm just playing. just playing. He recorded the ministries women he had with, to or from Yeshua, that the other gospel writers left out. So you'll hear a lot of information, and I like the idea that he portrayed Mary's feelings and what she went through during this time as well. And that's where we get that account from Luke. So we have a lot to be thankful for Luke. The last one is John. The Gospel of John is dealing with who? Everybody? The world. And basically, the lost. So he's like the catch-all to all groups. Okay? And his main emphasis about Jesus was that he was God. That he was deity. Okay? And that's what that symbolizes. The Gospel of John had an evangelistic purpose, and therefore the author's intention was to prove the messiahship of Yeshua. This goal becomes evident in John 20:31. But these are written that you may believe that Yeshua, Jesus, is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that believing ye may have life in his name. So he says that's the purpose of this, to make sure that you understand that you're dealing with God, that you're dealing with deity, not just a man, but with God himself. And that's why he'll go on to talk about in John chapter 1. Evidently, the apostle's goal in writing his gospel was to reach the lost. On one hand, he wanted to provide for the church a tool for evangelism. On the other hand, he wanted to strengthen the faith of those who already believed. So the book of John, if you're listening out there in the audience, is for two people groups. If you want to get strengthened to hear the words of Jesus and to believe that he is God, or strengthen your faith that he is God, then John is a great book. If you're Jewish, you go to Matthew. But if you're Gentile, you go, or you want to get a better understanding of what God has done, you go to John. But if you're not a believer and you want to know more about what God has to say, then it is in the Gospel of John. That's where you send a new believer or somebody who's just reading the Bible. Why? Because it will address the issue of being lost and being saved. So Luke was concerned with showing Yeshua to be fully human. The apostles' concern was to show that he was fully God. And that was the difference between him and Luke. By the time he wrote his gospel, Matthew, Mark, and Luke already had a wide circulation. While the three gospels preceded his were written to specific ethnic audiences, Jews, Romans, and Greeks, his gospel was written for the church at large and to unbelievers so that they would be convinced that Yeshua was the Messiah. He concentrated on adding those details the other three gospel writers had left out. A large body of material in his gospels are not found in Matthew, Mark, or Luke. While Mark was mostly interested in what Yeshua did, Yohanan John was more interested in what the Messiah said and taught. There are sermons and discourses in this gospel not found in other narratives. One of the things that you find in the book of John is this whole concept of where he's talking over and over and over again. I and the Father are one. Remember that? There's a movie, The Gospel of John. And The Gospel of John, it's over and over and over. It's repeated over and over again. He's always making this connection that I and the Father are one. If you see me doing things, it's like you're seeing the Father doing it. All of these things are all related based on that. Okay. While the apostles' main theme was Yeshua the Messiah, the Son of God, he interwove two sub-themes with his gospel. The first sub-theme is the conflict of light and darkness. Yohanan used those very terms, light and darkness, as well as night and day. He sometimes made statements that seem to be irrelevant unless this sub-theme is recognized. For example, he recorded that after the Messiah identified Judas as the betrayer at the last Passover, Judas left. The apostle added, and it was night. So it was important for him to say when he was leaving. Why? Because he's about to associate him doing the deeds that are done in the dark. And so that's why he mentions it. There was no reason to say that to the Jewish person because all Passovers are at night when the sun goes down. So that was like obvious. Says the apostle, obviously it was night. Passover is always observed at night, never in the daytime. It seems to be an irrelevant statement, except it is part of the apostle's sub-theme on the conflict of light and darkness. Yohanan was not just making a statement of fact that it was night outside. That was obvious. The point is that Judas himself was of the night and of the darkness. The deed he was about to do was not a deed that was done in the light or of the day. The second sub-theme of the Gospel of John is that the Messiah came for the purpose of being the Father's revealer, to reveal the Father. That's what you see me do, the Father in heaven also does. That explains why the apostles spend much more time on what Yeshua said and taught rather than on what he did. In all of his sermons, discourses, and teachings, he revealed the nature of the Father to man. And now we finally get to now that I've given you all that update, now I finally get to the scripture and we can start. No. I want to finish off with the scriptures that we're going to start on the first paragraph or the first section. And this is Luke. And now that you read it or when you see it, I hope that you're going to see Luke's perspective. Okay? So now as we're reading Luke, then we look for the L over here. Who is he writing to? The Greek mindset. And what was their thought? Order, structure, timeline, right? Okay, so now let's read this and see if it makes any difference to us. And if it doesn't, then keep your hands down because I don't want to know. Okay, it says, inasmuch as many have taken in hand to set in order a narrative of those things which have been fulfilled among us, even though three people have already gone and tried to accomplish those things, it says, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word delivered them to us, I've gotten information. It still seemed good. It was still important because something was missing. There needed to be order. It says, it seemed good to me also, having had perfect understanding of all things from the very first, like the word first, because it goes from first to second to third to fourth. In other words, in a succession, it says, all the things from the very first to write to you on what? Orderly account, most excellent Theophilus, that you may know the certainty of those things in which you were instructed. So So he's saying, Theophilus, I want to make sure that you get it in the order so that if you have to look at it, judge it, or whatever, you know that these things happen in such a way that there's order and there's structure, which basically says there's order and structure within Christianity. And it's saying it's important for us to know that God has everything under control. I think that's really important for us right now. We're going through all the virus and everything that's going on and so forth. And things look like they're very disorderly. Amen? You kind of try to figure out what is one person saying, the other person is saying something else, the doctor says this, another doctor says this. And so you're trying to figure it out, and you're trying to do the very best that you can, and praise God that that everybody is making decisions for their families to protect their families and doing what they need to do. That's awesome, and that's great. But there's also going to be a lot of confusion that's out there. And what I like about the fact that while everything might be going kind of a little crazy out there, that there's order. But the order is found in God's Word. God's Word always has the answer to everything that's going on. So if you want to preoccupy yourself with 197 classes that we'll be doing for the next 15 years, maybe 20 years, then it's a good thing. Because what happens is that you're about to see the perfect order of the life of Christ, the life of Messiah, and how it all works together in unison. And it's a beautiful thing what God does. In this case, in this first chapter, as we go into the beginning, this is the prelude, this is the explanation of why the Gospels were written, so that there would be order and we would get information. And then I'm just going to read chapter 1 of John and kind of just get the flair or the feeling of what John is trying to accomplish. Chapter 1 is about the eternal Word. You'll find that, and we're going to go over this next week or the next class. John chapter 1, 1 through 5. Now, what is John's, who is his audience? The world. And what is he trying to convey? Jesus is God. Very good. Excellent class. Oh, very good. Okay, so then here is his take. He starts off right off the bat with the one thing, and that is you need to understand that he is the creator of the world and that he is God, right off the bat. It says, in the beginning was the Word. The word there is memra. It has to do with the manifestation of God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And right off the bat, it didn't take but one verse to tell you exactly where he's going with his perspective. It's all about telling us, you should have peace in the midst of a virus or in the midst of financial trouble, in any situation that's going on. Just understand and go back to John 1:1 and realize that somebody's on the throne. Amen? Jesus is on the throne. The Father is on the throne. The Holy Spirit is on the throne in our hearts. And because of that, we can look up and see such great things that God has done. Josh and I were looking at, he was showing me some pictures that... I can't remember. What was the name? Was it the Voyager? Or which one was it that went into Saturn? There was a particular name, one of the satellites that went to Saturn. What's that? It was Voyager. And so the whole point was they ended the mission because it was just finishing. So it made a last-ditch shot to go into Saturn, actually, to finish their job. As it did that, it showed these pictures, these phenomenal pictures. And you're looking at it and says, no, that's got to be airbrushed or that's got to be Photoshopped or something. It's absolutely magnificent. Every part of that particular planet is just amazing. And then they were showing another one, Jupiter. Was it Jupiter, Josh? I think it was Jupiter. And it showed, it got a close-up view of that because there was another satellite that went in there. And they showed a close-up view of that. And you look at that and you're going like, that is impossible to replicate. There is no way that all of these things are in order. And when I saw that, I felt really small by comparison, you know. But you stop to think about everything out in the universe is out to kill you. There's nothing friendly in the universe. that a person can go. If you're going to try, somebody told me, if you even want to go to Mars, it's a one-way trip. There's no way to get back over here. So basically, you get over there, and you probably die of heat exposure and radiation, and you're done. So everything out there is meant to kill you. The world that God put together for us is absolutely gorgeous and magnificent and beautiful. You don't have to wear a spacesuit to go outside. You don't have to be living in a tent the rest of your life. Unless, of course, you're Nicole and they're all living in a tent, right? And I'm just playing. We don't have to do that. We have the ability to look at the beauty of nature. We had beautiful days. We had rain coming down today. We get a chance to see all those things. But that's John's perspective, is see the big picture here. He is God. And that's how he starts. This is God speaking to you as I go through the gospel. So listen up. This is God. He's on the throne. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. This is Jesus, Yeshua. All things. Everybody say all things. All things were made through him, and without him, nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. Remember the light and darkness? And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Here's a perfect example of John using all of those things, light and darkness, and then talking about the fact that Jesus was from the very beginning and is on the throne as well as the Father. I pray this whole series will be a blessing to you. And we'll be getting into the scripture verses, but I just felt it was important for us to get a better understanding of what's going on coming in. Before I leave, I just wanted to share with you a couple of things. The gospels that we'll be going through, the word for gospel is good news. And there's a lot of good news, and there's also some bad news within the scriptures. And the good news is this, that there is a place right now where God the Father, God the Son reside, where the Holy Spirit is residing as well, and even in our hearts. We know that that's the place where God lives. And because that's the place where God lives, it is an absolutely perfect environment. Now, the only people that are allowed as humans to be able to go there is very simple. All you have to do is be perfect. The white page here represents the perfection we need to be able to get to heaven. So let's recap. In order to get to heaven, a perfect place, you and I have to be perfect. That just disqualified all of humanity. Because if you've ever done one thing, that's all it takes for you not to be able to get into heaven. Now, there is another place, and it's called the Lake of Fire. And that's only for people that go there that are sinners and that have not, that's the condition of their sin when they die. The bad news then is, of course, because all have sinned, all have come short of the glory of God. So basically, you and I deserve to go to the Lake of Fire for eternity when we die. That's the bad news. And it's really bad news. It's to be separated from God. That's the hard part. And then being punished and everything else during that time, that's also bad. But it's that idea that you could have had a relationship with God and could have been in his presence. But how in the world can we do that? I've already mentioned heaven is a perfect place. You need to be perfect, but we're all sinners. And the dark page represents our darkened hearts as well as a result of sin. It is in this condition that all of us sinners find ourselves, myself included. The red page, though, this is the most beautiful page of all. The red page represents the shed blood of Jesus. The Bible gives us the answer to our problem. Our problem being that we're sinners. The answer is Jesus died for those sins, for your sins, that you might have everlasting life. Not an everlasting life in the place called, in the lake of fire, but everlasting life in the presence of God with other believers. God's word in the book of John talks about the fact that we're all in a bad condition. The whole world is in need of salvation. And Jesus is on the throne and he paid the price. Why? Because God the Father loved us so much that he sent his Son. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish, or should not perish, but have instead everlasting life. You and I have the ability to be able to get to heaven, not in our own merit, but through Jesus and Jesus alone. Jesus said these words, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man can come to the Father except by me. That means there is no other way, according to Jesus, that you can get to heaven to be with the Father. It says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. But that can only happen if Jesus is your only way for salvation. If you have other ways to get to heaven, if you have other ideas, or if you have other religions to be able to do that, just understand that Jesus pretty much made it very clear that he is the only way, the truth, and the life, and that you can't get into heaven. No matter how creative you want to be or how compassionate you want to be, Jesus is very simple, very clear about this. It's through him and no one else. I ask you, why not take the time right now and just give your life to the Lord? Accept him as your Savior and accept the fact that he is your only means for salvation. In a simple prayer, just pray with me wherever you're at. Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I now understand that I would have to spend the rest of eternity at the place called the Lake of Fire. But you made a way for me, Jesus. The good news is that you died on the cross, that you were buried, and you rose again on the third day to prove indeed that you are God. And you now sit at the right hand of the Father. I put all of my trust in you and in you alone for my salvation. And I ask you to come into my life right now. If you've done that, then you have now started a brand new intimate relationship with God. Read the book of John, and it will start telling you and start sharing with you the love and compassion that your Messiah, your Savior, Jesus, has had for you. For those of us that are believers, I pray that this journey that we're about to take will be very fruitful, that we'll learn more stuff, and it'll be absolutely great. We love you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us. In Jesus' powerful name, we do pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless you guys.